Hello, good morning. Thank you for being here today. Good morning. Welcome to RFF Live event titled The Future of Carbon Pricing, Exploring the Latest Global Developments. I'm Dallas Bertra. I'm the Darius Gaskin Senior Fellow here at Resources for the Future. RFF has had a number of events dealing with carbon pricing over recent months and years. Our most recent discussion was back in September, where we took a detailed look at the multitude of federal proposals that are currently being suggested in the legislature. And today's event now takes a broader look at what's going on at the global stage. We're very pleased to open the event today with comments from Celine Ramstein from the World Bank, who will set the stage by sharing highlights from the World Bank's annual State and Trends of Carbon report, pricing report. And we'll then hear from panelists who will be speaking to carbon pricing developments in several key economies, including Canada, China, and Germany. And I'll take advantage of the moderator's prerogative to ask a couple questions to get a discussion started, and then we'll save time for questions from the audience. So with that, I'd like to invite Celine here to get us started. Celine, thank you.
Thank you.
It's all yours.
Thanks. Thank you. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's great to be here with such an audience on a beautiful fall day morning. So I'm happy to be here and really happy that we're working with RFF to revive this series on carbon pricing following the revived interest that there seems to be on the Hill for these topics. So as we just heard at the Warbing, we cover carbon pricing every year in our annual report called the State and Trends of Carbon Pricing. And today I will be presenting you a very, very short presentation of what this report is. And because it's that time of the year, just to use an analogy, what I will do is really give you a taste of every single different bias that we describe in the report, but really on a superficial level. But the panel will be able to tell you much more. So without losing any time, what does our Thanksgiving table of carbon pricing look like? This is a map that we present every single year in this report, and we have it online on a dashboard that's called the carbon pricing dashboard that is really interactive. You can click on any jurisdiction, any carbon pricing initiative, and find much more details. So what do we see on this map, really briefly? First is that there are a lot of different initiatives. There are initiatives at the global level, at the regional level, subnational level. There are initiatives at different stages of consideration and implementation. Some are just being considered. Most of them are already implemented. You can might not be able to see the full legend here, but you can find more details online. What we've seen in the past years in terms of these initiatives is that we have a lot of interest in developing countries. It used to be really a developed countries agenda. We had a lot of discussion in Europe. We had discussion about 10 years ago, really active in the US. And I remember that because I was in this building 10 years ago interning for the Earth Day Network when it was the peak of the carbon discussion, carbon pricing discussion here. So it's interesting to see that the US is still on the map, but mostly at the state level. And who knows, maybe we'll be able to put in a different color at the federal level soon. We also see a lot of development in Latin America with a lot of interest. Some countries moving towards implementation, like Chile and Colombia. I'll get back to that in a minute. And finally, a lot happening in Asia, and a lot happening pretty fast, with China announcing, as you probably all know, it's the implementation of its own carbon market that would become the biggest carbon market in the world when it actually becomes operational. And we see that's a smaller story for now, but we see some development and some interest in a continent that used to be totally blank on our map, like Africa. We had the first carbon tax in Africa with South Africa, and we are engaged with Senegal or Côte d'Ivoire to try to explore with them what could carbon pricing at a domestic level look like for them. So one thing that we often get questioned on and that I haven't gotten to yet is how do we define carbon pricing? Because for those working in this area, you might know that everyone has its kind of own definition of what carbon pricing is. So for us, it's really easy in a sense. It's what we call explicit carbon pricing, meaning policies that put an explicit price on carbon. So any policy that explicitly says, I'm putting such amount of dollars per ton of CO2 equivalent, either carbon tax or ETSs or some other policies, we consider as carbon pricing. But that means that we leave a lot of other policies out of our definition. And when you look at the map, we get a lot of questions from countries. Here with some example like Egypt or India, telling us, okay, maybe we don't have a policy that meets your definition, but we're still doing a lot in terms of energy taxation or fossil fuel subsidies removal, etc. And that's a very good point. We totally recognize that this map is excluding a lot of policies that still de facto send either a negative or a positive price on carbon. And I mentioned Chile earlier. I could also have mentioned Ecuador. You all heard about the importance of carbon pricing for people in the streets, and they don't make the difference if it's explicit, implicit, whatever it is. What they see is the price effect that they experience on their everyday life, that is either an encouragement to take more transportation or low carbon solution, either just a weight on their bill at the end of the month that they usually don't like. So we recognize the importance of expanding a little bit, either our definition or at least our coverage. And we're working with IMF, OECD, IEA, and many other, including here at RFF, brilliant economists that can help us to put the story together. And going back to my Thanksgiving analogy, it's actually really hard to do. Because right now, the way it looks is that carbon pricing and just climate policies in general, you have a lot of different policies in different form, different shapes. Some are overlapping, some are countervailing. You can have a country that both have climate policy and fossil fuel subsidies. So to get to a point where we're able to send a clear signal and to tell you a clear story of where does this country specifically sits in terms of overall carbon pricing, to get to this veggie turkey that I thought was a good way of explaining that in short time, it is difficult. But we're working on it, and we're confident we'll get to some degree of clarity in the next years on this, and we see a huge value to do that. So now, going back to my pure explicit carbon pricing definition. So what we've seen in the past year is that there is an increase, a very fast increase of carbon pricing policies, even if we look just at carbon pricing and ETSs. As I mentioned, with the Chinese ETSs, the coverage of greenhouse gases emission around the world of all those initiatives will jump to 20%. And if you go back to 10 years ago when I was here, it has more than quadrupled. So it's really an area where there is really fast progress, and it's growing really rapidly. Now, this is good, and it's good that more and more countries are interested. However, what we also see is that the level of price and the level even of coverage within the sectors of the country that are actually covered is not that high. So it's impossible to read here, but that's kind of on purpose, because it is impossible to get a clear sense of where are all of these different prices in these different initiatives. They're all different. But most of them are in the bottom end. So 51% of the emission currently covered by some type of carbon pricing initiatives are under $10 per ton of CO2. So this is not a lot. And we also often get the question of, okay, but how high is enough? How high should it be to be aligned with the Paris Agreement, for example? Well, at the World Bank, we did a report on this a couple of years ago with Nick Stern and Joe Stiglitz, trying to answer that exact question. How high is enough? How high does it need to be aligned with the Paris Agreement goal? And we came up with this very simple answer, $40 to $80 per ton of CO2 by 2020. And as you can see, we're pretty far from here. So I should caveat this number by saying that it also depends on all the other policies you have around. This is assuming ambitious policy. If you have extra ambitious policy, maybe you need a bit less of carbon pricing explicitly. If you have no policy, you probably need more. So, and it will depend in each country, but it's helpful to have at least some type of reference. So that's how we saw this report and its goal. So looking at this reference, what we see is that we have less than 5% of the 20% I mentioned earlier, so 5% of the emissions covered currently that are priced within this range. So we're really far from where we would need to be. And the reason I'm saying that, and the reason why we say that carbon pricing need to be higher, is not just because we like high prices or because we like high burden on people. It's just because the very basic ideas many of the economists in the room know of carbon pricing is to send a price signal that then leads to change in behaviors. So it doesn't mean that everyday people need to feel it on their daily commute, but it does mean that someone in the economy has to feel it so that the signal is strong enough to engage, to generate a shift to the low carbon economy. And right now, with the carbon pricing initiatives we have around the world, the signal is just not strong enough. Well, now let me turn to a positive message, because I don't want to leave everyone really sad and depressed after my presentation. As we see more and more carbon pricing initiative emerging, and even with smaller prices, some prices have been increasing, like the EU ETS, for example. And this leads to more revenues. And this is good news for government. We get actually more and more interest from finance minister in carbon pricing because they see it as a fiscal policy. And they start looking at it within their overall fiscal policy framework. So here we have $45 billion in 2018, which, as you can see, is a really massive increase just in the past 2 years. I will say, though, $45 billion sounds like a big number. If you compare it to these fossil fuel subsidies I was mentioning earlier, and those working on these know how many different estimates of fossil fuel subsidies there are, but even taking the low end of the estimates, we're still talking about volumes 10 times bigger than that. So $45 billion for explicit carbon pricing is a good start, and it will certainly increase as more initiatives get developed and as prices increase, but it's still really small compared to fossil fuel subsidies. So as we think about integrative system and looking at the fiscal policy as a whole, the very first step is to look at fossil fuel subsidies to be fully consistent. But carbon pricing revenues are important, and we have a full report on this and 18 case studies that we published in August, because they can help government to meet to use these revenues to meet their own priorities and objective. It can be environment objective, it can be for climate projects, but it can also be for other development priorities. It can be for health, it can be for education, and it can be for general government budget recycling. Any options are open depending on the law in place and constraint in the jurisdiction and depending on the priorities. So if you want to know more about that, it's quite an interesting topic, and there are very interesting stories and lessons to learn from how jurisdictions have used their revenues so far. So let me just summarize some of the key messages really fast that we saw in the past years in terms of trends and development. So what we see in this map is that there are more and more initiatives that come in very different shape or form. So there is not such a thing as one recipe for one carbon pricing policy. There is also no one price around the world. There are many, many different prices. There is, however, a lot of collaboration and cooperation and sometimes linking going on between these initiatives and many experience that they can that each jurisdiction can learn from each other. What we also see is that it's hard to get it right from the first try. So we see a lot of countries adjusting over time, either tightening their cap or increasing their coverage or their price, which sometimes is hard to do. So we also see, or takes a lot of time, like we saw in the EU ETS, for example. So what we also see is that countries now try to build in, or countries or jurisdictions, try to build in flexibility so that they don't have to have a 5 or 10 years negotiations period to change their instrument. They can have different mechanisms built in that allow for quicker fixes. But this also means sometimes delay. We'll hear about the China experience in a minute, but China, we announced it was launched in 2017. It's still in my map. It's still not really implemented and operational. So we'll hear about that in a minute. Why is that? Is it a good thing that there is delay, just to make sure that once this ETS is launched, it will actually work well and be doing the effect we want it to do? Or what is behind that? It is a question that's quite important. And finally, a very important thing, especially for this past year, is that as much as we see positive development and new initiative emerging, you don't see on the map the one that got removed. There are stories of very strong political pushback. So we can always argue that it was not just carbon pricing or carbon tax for the Gilets jaunes in France, for example. It was a broader context, et cetera. But we do see a very strong pushback for some carbon pricing policy, which leads to a lot of other things that I will not have time to talk about today, but the use of revenues is one important story to tell. How do you communicate carbon pricing? How do you make sure it's fair? Are very important consideration. And the debate, at least the way we see it at the World Bank, has really shifted from the ideal economic instrument that carbon pricing is, and we still believe it's a very strong one, to maybe second or third best of like what is actually realistically doable in the political economy context, in depending on the people and the government's priorities. So before concluding, let me just mention the international aspect, because that's something we also look at in this report. You probably all familiar with the Article 6 and the negotiations going on to have the future of the clean development mechanism and to allow some trading going on at the international level. We looked at all of the NDCs that are these climate plans that the countries came forward with. And what we saw is that the vast majority of them mention carbon pricing, and they say we want to use carbon pricing. And what they mean by that, some of them, I would say a dozen of them, mean domestic carbon pricing. So what I showed earlier, having a carbon tax, having an ETS, acting on their own emission. Most of them, though, mean money. most developing countries see carbon pricing in the spectrum of the Kyoto Protocol and the old clean development mechanism as a source to attract climate finance. So in this vision of the carbon markets of the future, there is a lot of demand from the carbon from the developing countries to get money flowing to them to finance climate projects through some type of Article 6 mechanisms that still has to be defined, but hopefully we'll see and learn more progress about that at the COP in Madrid in just 2 weeks. And there are other developments that we follow in the reports, the CORSIA mechanism for aviation, which is very much still being debated, and just other type of offsets that we try to monitor. And you can also see, if you're curious about that, as Article 6 negotiations are still happening, there are a couple of institutions that got together to pilot it, to look at what could an Article 6 transaction look like in reality. And there is a whole report listed here mapping these pilots. So just to conclude, and maybe to give some food for thought for the panel, after having done, I think, for these reports at the bank for about a decade, what we see is that the case for carbon pricing is probably clearer than ever. From the economic side, the economists have been making this case for a very long time. So there is really no more doubt about the power of this instrument to reduce emission and of the theory of it. There is, however, a growing recognition that it's not the silver bullet that we might have wanted to see. It needs to be part of a policy packages, that it needs to be thought with all the other policies and climate policies that are out there. So we have a pretty good sense, I think, of what needs to be done, many experiences to learn from, and yet it's not happening fast enough. I showed you very different examples of how it's not happening fast enough, nor deep enough, nor broad enough. This coverage is just not there yet. So how can we accelerate that? How can we get to a point where the price signal is helping to drive the economy towards a low carbon and resilient one? Well, that's one of my questions for the panel and from all of you. And I will stop here to let ample time for the discussion. If you want to learn more about what we do, about all of these instruments that I really only had time to briefly mention, you can find online our interactive on a dashboard, and all our reports are publicly available on the World Bank website. And with that, I'll turn over to the panel, and I'll be here for the Q&A if you have any question at the end. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Great. Okay, thank you very much, Celine. That was a great introduction. And so we are lucky to have representatives to speak to us about three important national economies. And you have information on your seat about the backgrounds on the speakers. I'm going to first start with Craig Wickel from the Canadian Embassy, and let's hear some remarks about progress in Canada.
Okay, thank you. And good morning, everyone. Great to see such a big turnout this morning. I've been asked just to give some readouts on political developments in Canada as we just came through a federal election, which had some significant implications for carbon pricing. So yesterday, the new Canadian cabinet was sworn in, and so we actually have a new government. We're no longer in what we call writ period. The election results signal a continuity of existing legislation and policy for carbon pricing in Canada. What that means is that as of this year, every jurisdiction in Canada has a price on carbon pollution that is equivalent to $20 per ton. That will rise to $30 per ton next year, $40 per ton in 2021, and $50 in 2022. As you are probably aware, Prime Minister Trudeau's Liberal Party will form a minority government. So they got 157 seats in Parliament, which is 13 short of a majority. Unlike many European countries, Canada does not have a lot of experience with formal coalition governments, but we do have a lot of experience with minority governments. In fact, 14 of them since 1867, and four since 2004. These tend to last anywhere between 18 and 30 months, so about a year and a half to 2.5 years. Given that the incoming government is a strong minority, and it would take a minimum of three opposition parties to vote no confidence and bring it down, we assess it's highly likely this government will last at least as long as the average minority government in Canada, and quite possibly longer. Three opposition parties, the New Democrats, the Bloc Québécois, and the Greens, support the current carbon pricing regime or even stronger forms of carbon pricing. And therefore, it's highly unlikely that the three of them are going to combine with the other major party in Parliament, the Conservatives, to repeal the Greenhouse Gas Pollution Pricing Act, which implemented carbon pricing in Canada. Carbon pricing figured prominently in the campaign. It's important to note when we talk about public buy-in that close to two-thirds of Canadians supported parties that support carbon pricing in its current form. And in its broadest sense, that means both effectively an emissions trading scheme and a carbon tax. And if we consider that the Conservative Party also supported an ETS, if my math is right, 97.6% of Canadians who voted for some form of carbon pricing. So given this result, most commentators across the political spectrum have observed that with this result, carbon pricing in Canada is here to stay. And if that's true, then the debate will probably shift to what forms of carbon pricing deliver the best results, what's the right type of price, what other types of measures are needed, and so on, similar to what the World Bank presentation was getting at. One other key result of the election are regional disparities. Western energy-producing provinces of Alberta and Saskatchewan did not elect one Liberal MP. These provincial governments in particular, have indicated that they will push hard for provincial economic interests, and that will be a major challenge for federal-provincial relations going forward. In order to balance these interests, the policy of the government will remain. We can expect the incoming federal government to continue to work hard to get energy infrastructure built. That includes pipelines. It also includes high-voltage electricity transmission lines to the United States, and at the same time promoting various methods of reducing Canada's overall emissions. Do I have a couple minutes to talk about Quebec, California? Very briefly, I was asked about the possible implications of the U.S. government's suit against the government of California for the cap and trade scheme with Quebec. Very tough to say right now. Took us by surprise as much as by others, I would say. Ultimately, it's a question of state power and U.S. constitutional law, and we're not going to speculate on how that will turn out. We understand it's one of dozens, maybe 66 current litigation cases between the U.S. and California governments. So for the time being, it's business as usual for the Quebec-California arrangement. The lawsuit does create some uncertainty in terms of not just carbon pricing arrangements, but also other types of subnational arrangements, including emergency management assistance. Province of Quebec has indicated it will continue no matter what with its cap and trade scheme. So if California were to be separated from that, it would just be a Quebec scheme, but it would be a smaller market, but it would still continue. And of course, we'll continue to follow this issue closely as it moves forward in the U.S.
That's really great, Greg. Thank you. A great, great introduction and summary. Thank you. So next, I want to invite my colleague, Richard Morgenstern, here at Resources for the Future. And Dick has done work in China for nearly two decades around various types of emissions trading programs, back to sulfur dioxide. And currently, you've been studying the emergence of carbon markets.
Right. Well, thanks, Dallas. I just got back last night from China, okay? So I'll think I can report on some current activities, but I may be a little wobbly here given the jet lag. So China has announced fairly ambitious long-run plans. They want to introduce a nationwide carbon pricing system that covers multiple industries. In the short run, they're starting with the power sector, and their power sector constitutes about 40% of their total emissions. There are approximately 2,000 power plants, coal plants in China, which are going to be subject to regulation in this near-term program that they are about to launch. Interestingly, simultaneously with launching their trading scheme, they are reforming the power sector. So if you recall, power used to be provided by a monopoly in China, and in the mid-80s, there was some reforms that were introduced, and now they're moving rather rapidly to accelerate reforms. Currently, about a third of the power in China is subject to market pricing, and the expectation is that will rise rapidly over the next decade, concurrent with the rollout of their emissions trading scheme. So what's interesting and what's new about the China system? Well, the most exciting thing, I think, is that they're doing it quite differently than virtually anyone else in the world has done it. They're using what's called a tradable performance standard, not a cap and trade scheme that we are familiar with. Now, academic researchers, including Richard Newell, including Carolyn Fisher, and others have been studying tradable performance systems going back for a long time, but the studies have largely been academic in nature. It's true that part of the California scheme does have some rate-based elements in it as applied to heavy industry, but there's a lot of constraints and limits on that. So that's not really a perfect example of what China is doing. China is trying to apply this rate-based mechanism to the entire electric sector. And that is quite a novel thing to do. And you might say, well, why are they doing it? Well, there are many advantages, okay, but there are many disadvantages. And the advantages that I would stress is that the rate-based schemes adjust the stringency automatically with the level of economic activity. So if the economy is in a boom period, there are effectively more allowances available. If the economy is in a downturn, there are fewer allowances available. That's not the way cap and trade works. Cap and trade has a fixed number of allowances, although there have been some, with the introduction of banking and borrowing, there's some flexibility there as well. The other interesting thing about a tradable performance standard is that the price increases, the price of the allowances, are likely going to be smaller. And the implications of that are there's going to be less emissions leakage. So for any given reduction in emissions overall, you're going to have smaller price increases. And as I say, there'll be less leakage. Thirdly, it's a familiar scheme. Chinese have been regulating various emissions, not just CO2, but conventional pollutants, on the basis of rates for some time. And this is kind of a scheme that follows within their institutional structure. Now, the big disadvantage of a tradable performance scheme is it's a lot more expensive, or potentially a lot more expensive, than a cap and trade scheme to reduce emissions. It raises the costs, and it introduces various distortions in the decisions that power plant operators would make. That's a problem, because I would say environmental economics, but all of us probably in the room are concerned with achieving environmental goals at least cost. And this is potentially a significant departure from that model. Now, how much of a departure, I guess, is the obvious question. And we're not going to really know until the system gets started, which is expected to be in 2020, by the way, is when trading is supposed to start. But I've been doing some modeling work with several colleagues. Larry Goulder out of Stanford, a student of his, Shanling Wang, also at Stanford, and a former research assistant here at RFF, who's now at Yale, J.E. Liu. And we've tried to develop numerical estimates of what the cost burden will be on the Chinese economy of achieving these reductions. And the numbers are fairly high, I guess I might say. Okay, our estimates, our best estimates, are that the costs of achieving a given reduction will be about 40% more than a comparable cap and trade scheme. Okay, now you say, is 40% a lot or a little? Well, I guess that's a judgment call, but to me it seems like a lot. And I think you have to view this as sort of a grand experiment. How is this going to work out over time? The Chinese have pledged to move emissions trading schemes to other sectors, cement, aluminum, steel, and so on. They have not said that they're going to use a tradable performance standard in these sectors. So it's not clear what they're going to actually do. But presumably, this experiment with electricity will teach them a lot. Now, one little side aspect of this that you might find interesting, another perhaps advantage of a tradable performance standard, although this is also can be incorporated into a cap and trade, is the ability to benchmark different types of sources. And what benchmarking does is it allows certain facilities to have more emissions per ton or per dollar of output of production than other facilities. You think of this, if it was applied, say, to the steel sector, you would think that steel firms that were producing specialized steel might have different emission rates than firms that were producing other types of steel. But in electricity, of course, it's a totally homogeneous output. So the idea of having different benchmarks is not something that has been widely used, certainly around the world. But the Chinese are doing that. The question is, how many benchmarks are they going to use? They started out talking about as many as 11 different benchmarks to reflect a range of different technologies and vintages of power plants that they have in operation. The current thinking is that they're going to have 3 or possibly 4 benchmarks. So the advantage of benchmarks to them, or to anybody, is that it allows you to be sensitive to distributional issues. If all of the older, less efficient power plants were located, let's just say, in one particular province, then the burden of participating in the scheme would be much higher for that province. In this case, that was the original thinking, to have 11 different benchmarks. As I say, now they've scaled it back considerably to 3 or 4. But even with 3 or 4, we find that these cost increases that I've mentioned are likely to occur. Now, how it plays out remains to be seen, but there's a lot of excitement in China about this going forward. They've started training sessions with provincial officials and power plant operators all across the country. And as I say, real trading is supposed to start next year. So stay tuned. Thanks.
That sounds like a real-time update. Getting off the plane last night is great. Thanks so much, Dick. That's terrific. Sure. So next I want to ask Nora Lola from the Henrik Boll Foundation to speak to us about events in Germany, but also I want to invite you to bring the audience into up to date with respect to changes in the last 18 or 24 months in the European ETS, because I think it's little noted in the North America of what has how that market has transformed.
Okay, thank you so much. Good morning, everyone. I guess that's working. I'll start actually with the European level. As Germany is part of the European Union, we are obviously part of the European emission trading system. The first bad news is this is, I guess, a good example of a non-working carbon pricing, unfortunately, system. So what we have seen, this European emission trading system was established in 2005, so there's quite some time now which we have the system in place. As probably every one of you knows, the allowance certificates in these markets were chosen for political reasons to be very high. And that's the whole reason why the system isn't working. So I just checked this morning. Right now we are at a price of about $26 per carbon ton emission. That is way too low, how we already heard from Celine, to have any like successful effects to see shifts within the economy and new technologies. So this is where we are at. We have a new European Commission in place, which announced what they call a European Green Deal. And as part of this, we are also expecting new developments within the trading system and more policies in place. But this will only take place probably from next year on. So what happened is that Germany finally acknowledged, and that's also mainly due to the big protests we see in place now going on since a year, the Fridays for Future protests, mainly driven by young people going on streets every single Friday since a year, calling for more ambitious climate action. And then also the outcome of the European Parliament elections in May showed that the Green Party in Germany was actually the second strongest party, very closely to the Conservative Party. So that was a strong call. And finally, sort of, we saw a wake up within the German government that there needs to be more done on climate action now. And also not just doing this whole sort of finger pointing to the European level and sort of they'll deal with it. We'll wait for the European level to deal with it, right? So that's the reason why the German government just 2 weeks ago announced a new, what they call a climate package. So it's a whole bunch of new climate policies, which will be implemented in a pretty short time, because again, they are saying there is really a time pressure. So they called out for very ambitious implementations of these new policies. And one part is, and that's really the news in Germany, is a carbon price, a national carbon price, in addition to the European emission trading system we will be implementing. So the plan is, and again, I'm coming mostly with more darker news, but I would see my role in sort of freshening up the discussion, and I think there's just a lot of to learn from. So this carbon price, which will be implemented, the plan is to implement that and start with that 2021 in Germany. And again, it is in addition to the European emission trading system. And that price will be set at the beginning with $11 per carbon ton, which is, again, way too low. So climate experts in Europe say this price would need to be chosen around $50 to $60 to have any like successful effect. So that is the bad news about this. This climate policies, though, they introduce a little bit more than just this carbon price. And I should mention that this carbon price plan foresees an increase by $6 each year in the following years. So at least it is a pretty fast developing increase of that price. The policy also foresees, and that is, I think, more something to learn from. We finally implement sort of an ownership, a responsibility by sector. So that means from now on, every ministry is responsible for its respective sector where we see a lot of emissions cost. And I think in Germany, that's especially finger point and finally to the transport sector, where we haven't seen any good reductions of the emissions yet. And also there's a lack of very successful policies in place we haven't seen yet. And so for the first time with this new climate policy in place, we will see that there will be what they call a climate committee with independent experts, which will be asked every year in front of the parliament where they see the reductions happening per sector. And if they don't see the called reductions per sector, so per minister, they will be sort of charged and will do more ambitious. So what is, I think, the exciting news about this new climate package in Germany is that we will have a yearly sort of control of the achieved reductions per sector, and so a real ownership per minister who is responsible for their reductions. And I should mention the carbon price in Germany was especially implemented because the European system only covers the power sector and heavy industry sector. So what is totally missing is the building sector and the transport sector, and that is where we will have the national carbon price now in place for. And I mean, just maybe to fire up the discussion again. So in Germany, we do see a reduction of CO2 emissions per year right now with about 10 million ton CO2 emissions per year, which is good, but not good enough. And so climate experts tell us to reach our national and European climate targets, we would need a reduction per year of 25 million. So more as double as much as we are reaching right now. So that clearly shows like what we have in place right now on the German level and on the European level is not enough. And so I'm definitely calling for a mix of policies. I don't believe like carbon pricing can be the only solution. And it has been showing on the European level that developments go too slow. And I think I could share one example where we have seen a lot of positive development within a pretty short time is when we implemented in 2000 the feed-in tariff in our electricity system. And that was really to make renewables grow. And that had a lot of success, actually. So coming from 6% renewables in 2000, we now are almost about 40% of renewables in our electricity mix in Germany. So we have been able to really make the renewables grow. And the even more important uses, we really helped to decrease the cost for those technologies, so mainly solar and wind, so often offshore technologies. And that took some bold political decisions, and I think that's what we need to see more. So with that feed-in tariff, we not only made it possible for private investors to invest in solar or wind as renewables and make them grow, but we also broke down with the system we had in place, which was a monopoly of four big utilities providing energy by then. But we opened up the market so everyone could provide energy. And with the feed-in tariff, there comes also the decision that renewables always feed into our system first to really guarantee that renewables are going to be the future in our electricity system. So I think this is a very successful policy we have seen in place. And again, it also really broke up with the power system. And I think we need similar policies in place for the transport and the building sector in the future.
That's terrific, and this is a great start. I want to now pepper the panel with a question for each of the speakers at the highest level, what occurs to me as a moderator in terms of trying to achieve the goals that you describe. And I'm going to start with you, Craig, and ask you, given Canada's intent to meet its NDC commitments under the Paris Accord, and the current pricing regime appears to be important, but only modest in terms of being able to achieve that overall goal. So what does Canada have in mind?
Well, I think the government's been fairly clear that we will not meet our NDC through carbon pricing alone. Mm-hmm. It's a good chunk of it. And, you know, the current, from 2017 levels, we were at 716 megatons. The projection now is 592 by 2030, which is 223 megatons. It's a pretty good chunk of our NDC, but it's not all the way there. But the other part of it, the Pan-Canadian framework is one pillar of that is pricing. Another pillar of that is complementary measures, and that can be anything from energy efficiency, which I think is a big one in our case. We're a big cold, sparsely populated country that needs to work on energy efficiency, land use changes, including planting a lot of trees, carbon capture, utilization, and storage. We're already packing away 7 megatons per year, and there's a lot of developing technology at 4 projects in Canada, in Alberta and Saskatchewan, by the way. Electrification of transport. We're expecting to have you can drive the Trans-Canada Highway by 2022 on electricity, and most of it generated by clean hydroelectricity. So, I mean, these are all things we call. It comes into the third pillar, which is the innovation agenda. Clean energy and innovation that we're pursuing, R&D to, you know, and these are emerging technologies, including CCUS, but also nuclear, hydrogen, and working on energy efficiency. Mm. And that's how the government is planning to get those missing 79 megatons down to our NDC by 2030.
Mm. So like Nora and like the advice that Celine gave us, it's sort of a policy mix is what may have.
That's exactly
emerged.
Right.
Dick, a question that I think puzzles economists generally in thinking about China is you look at, you observe a mixed economy, which you explained a bit. But I understand that the organization of the economy often describes production quotas on individual facilities. So are those quotas going to remain in place likely under, and how will emission reductions be achieved given production at individual facilities are maintained?
No, it's a great question, Dallas. And of course, when you think about a complex economy, the production quotas might apply in steel or aluminum. I'm not really sure about that. But electricity is what I've been working on a little bit more recently. So the Chinese electricity system was and has been based on production quotas, as you call them. They call them guaranteed hours of production, which essentially power plants are required and assured that their output will be sold at a given price up to a certain amount of output. The reform that's been going on for many years now, but is now accelerating, is to allow plants to sell beyond their guaranteed hours. So the guaranteed hours levels have pretty much been frozen. Mm. And as the economy has grown, incremental production has gone into the market, which, as I say, is now about a third. So as that increases, on the margin, it's already gets to the point where it's market based. So I think it's going to lead to a fairly flexible system in time. Is my answer to that question.
Okay.
Other sectors, I'm less knowledgeable about those, but I understand there's reform going on there as well. I want to pick up on one thing that was just mentioned about Canada and the multiple strategies. You know, I've been going to China on and off for, gosh, a long time now. And this last trip, I was amazed at two things. A, how clean Beijing was, okay, which is always an indicator. And people say it wasn't just the time I was there, but it was literally there's some data to support that. And secondly, the amount of new technology that's in place in China is really amazing. I mean, the number of electric cars you see on the street is, you know, kind of phenomenal. And there's just, it's a rapidly changing society, as we all know.
Yeah, that's really interesting. And so, Nora, I have a question for you. Yeah, I tried to tease you out, and you took the exact opposite point of view of what I was trying to lead you with talking about transformation in the European carbon market. But I think the audience would want to observe that 24 months ago, the price in the ETS was about €8.
That's
today,
true.
It's up around €24. It was as high as €26 or €27. That's a tripling in less than 24 months. That's what I meant by transformation of the market. And so I just want to draw you out on, when I look at the recent decisions, just very recent decisions in Germany to become just the third jurisdiction in the world to implement economy-wide pricing, counting California and Canada, and at a level that will arise to €35 by 2025. Yet repeatedly I hear many German observers take a pessimistic interpretation on this. Can you help us understand the thinking that's going on the ground in Germany, why that's not good news?
Yeah, I think the short answer is, again, like coming from a way too low price, getting to a too low price is still not good enough, right? So, no, but seriously, I mean, again, we have seen, even with this price in place, we don't see big transformation happening. So in the case of Germany, it's unfortunately still true that coal plays a too big role in our electricity mix. So it's still about 40%. And actually, I just learned it's the same number as for China. So 40% of all our CO2 emissions are just produced within the electricity sector. And 75% of those are by producing and mining coal. So we know pretty exactly who we, like where we need to see a shift rather like soon than anything later, right? So again, either you really choose a very high CO2 price, or if that's not high enough, and that's still the case in the European system and also in the German system, you need other policies in place. And so now the German government did finally decide on a phase out of coal by 38, which again, that is too late, right? They cause 75% of our CO2 emissions. So that would be a big chunk to take out. We are getting there slowly, right? But it's too slow. The phase out, though, I should mention, is in phases, so we will be phasing out every year now several coal plants in Germany. That is the good news. And some experts say that will be such a strong signal to the market that probably the phase out of coal will be happening rather soon than late. And the 38 goal will probably be happening sooner than by 38. But again, right, even though if we see in crisis of carbon prices, it still has to be higher to have real effects.
Well, I think I'll observe then that the real transformation I've heard about this morning is the transformation in expectations about the role and possibility and level of carbon pricing out on the global stage. That's what's really remarkable. We now have a few minutes for some questions from the audience. We have a roaming microphone that'll come around and find you. If you have a question, please raise your hand. Let's start in the back here with this woman back there. Can you get the microphone to her? Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, thank you all for the wonderful presentations. I'm Laura, a graduate student from Johns Hopkins SAIS. And I guess my question is directed to Richard. So you've been talking about China's proposed ETS system for the whole electricity sector. So I'm just wondering, because China has been trying so hard to transform from coal to electricity and trying to electrify basically everything. And what would you think would be the impact of this carbon trading system on the electrification of like the coal industry, and how is it going to affect possible the future of China's NDC and like the emissions, the carbon emissions?
Yeah, it's a good question. Okay, so the question is really, how is the whole emissions trading regime going to affect the trend towards electrification of the Chinese economy? And I have not tried to model that, okay, but I could certainly speculate that what you're going to do is you're going to raise the price of, certainly if you focus it solely on the electric sector, you're going to raise the price of electricity. And to the extent that that occurs, presumably that will slow down the trend, the rather powerful trend, as you say, to electrification. I guess the one caveat, of course, as I mentioned, the tradable performance standard approach that they are proposing to use is going to work in the other way in terms of lowering the price effects per se. So by having smaller price effects than you might under a cap and trade, you are going to offset a little bit that trend that I mentioned.
Mm-hmm. Another question on the aisle here.
Thank you. Excellent presentations. Thank you very much. I'm Al Gertzel, Seneca Creek Associates, and I want to do just a quick follow-up question to the last one for Richard, and then another question. And the follow-up question is, I think part of that question was, how will the ETS affect the coal industry in China? China's heavily dependent on coal for electric production, so I'd be interested in your answer to that.
Yeah, no, I think the answer is straightforward. It's going to move against coal. There's no question about that.
Okay. And my question would be for the panel at large, or maybe Craig, maybe Celine, and that is, how are the various countries, Canada, for example, dealing with international trade? So that, you know, are there border adjustments associated with some of these ETSs and so forth? Thank you.
Craig, do you want to take that one first?
Yeah, I think that's still a work in progress. We're still dealing with the whole, Article 6 negotiations. The Canadian system is designed to present leakage to other jurisdictions in the sense that there's effectively an ETS, which is called the output-based pricing system on major emitters, major industry, power generators, et cetera. And that's designed to get them to put carbon pricing and for them to seek efficiencies, but not to sort of, move to other jurisdictions. So I would have to say that in our trade agreements, for instance, we've just recently renegotiated NAFTA, of course, with the U.S. and Mexico. But I mean, there are stronger environmental provisions in that. I would have to go back and actually look at exactly how they would affect, the specific carbon aspects of it. But it's certainly they've taken on a much greater profile in the more recent trade agreements that we've negotiated.
How about Dick, about competitiveness?
Well, I mean, it's a concern with any country, okay? Every country has concerns about competitiveness, certainly. And I don't have any really unique insights about China. I think the use of a tradable performance standard will probably limit the competitive aspects that might otherwise occur. But I'm sure that there will be some, at least you would be able to model some as a result of this scheme. Certainly, by focusing on electricity per se, or only electricity, that's a limited, important, but still a limited part of the economy. As they move to trying to move some carbon pricing regime onto manufactured goods, it's going to become much more complicated. How they do it, what mechanism they use, will have a lot of implications, including for competitiveness.
Mm-hmm. Nora, this has been a big issue in Europe.
There is a rising discussion again within the new European Commission about a potential border carbon tax, also as an idea of, right, as a big European market to address. So that would mean that for products imported to the EU market, you would look at if wherever they got produced, there is a sort of carbon price in place. And if not, we would, by importing them, put a carbon price on those products. That's one idea out there. Again, it's still a discussion. But I think, there needs to be more of such ideas to address the question of competitiveness, because that's also the burden we saw so far, that always this argument by industry was made. And then again, those carbon prices were chosen very low. And so that doesn't lead us anywhere, right? So we need new ideas to be implemented on that.
Do you want to comment on the degree to which there's empirical evidence that there has been a leakage problem or a competitiveness challenge for Europe so far?
I think in reality that hasn't been a really strong, actually. We have seen, European companies, there's like very little cases which have been moving to Latin America, to China. Electricity prices or other taxes are usually, of course, a factor, but never the only one. And also we have seen some of them, Siemens, coming back at the end because the production wasn't as efficient, successful as hoped for. So I think the picture is always when it is at the end producing, at least like manufacturing, that there's really other factors which can play a role for industry, and they have realized like it's not a good game to play to only look to the cheaper electricity prices in a region.
Yeah, very good. More questions? Okay, can I bring the microphone up front? I'm going to collect three questions, and then we can go across the panel and try to address them. So right in the front, there was one. Hold your fire panel on the response until we get them out.
Hi, this is Carlos Muñoz. And my question would be, Mexico is, we're very happy we approved the Mexican ETS just this year, and we'll be starting next year. And we have had a carbon tax for the past 5 years. So in a sense, it's moving in both directions. And my question was, it matters what your trading partners do. So if California is moving and Canada is moving, then our politicians are encouraged to, or at least less afraid of, moving towards positive carbon pricing. And my question for the panel was, how do their respective trading partners influence what decisions you take?
Great question.
Yes, the question is, I've always thought that either you choose price or you choose quantities. And it confuses me the way you see it, Germany, because you seem to be complaining about low prices where you chose quantity. Prices should be optimal to the quantity you chose, and it will reflect on good technological progress, good other policies. So I'm not really understanding. And as Professor Weizmann would say, it all depends on the things we don't know.
Another question there was... right next there.
Yeah. Great. This is Jon Berg from the Norwegian Embassy, so I can just mention that the price now in Norway is about $50 a ton, and it will, and at the new government platform, it has been decided to increase that by 5% per year up to 2025. But the question is, if I may, to the World Bank, is do you have any modeling how the world should reach the net zero target by 2050? How big should the price on carbon be then?
We'll invite Celine to come up and answer that also, if you know the answer to Celine. And one more question, right straight back.
This is specific to Germany. I'm not super familiar how Germany is thinking about the interactions between the national cap and trade system and the EU ETS. And there must be, I imagine, concerns about volatility and market uncertainty for participants in the for especially firms that participate in both ETSs. So how is Germany thinking about these interactions? What are the main guidelines?
Okay, let's go down the panel. Craig, do you want to start tackling it, whichever of these questions you'd like, or all three of them if you can?
Well, I think the main one from our perspective is the first one about how our trading partners affect our policy. And
who would that trading partner be?
Well, yeah, there's one really big one. And of course, Mexico is a very, very important one as well. But I mean, the U.S. alone is pretty close to 75% in and out. So obviously, it's a big consideration. I think there was a period when, you know, when our current government or incoming government was first elected in 2015, there was a period of relative alignment in climate policy between the three NAFTA countries. Of course, things have changed as they always do. Our government has maintained that we were going to go and do this, hopefully together, but alone if necessary, and they've stuck to that. It's taken a while to negotiate it with the provinces, frankly. It's taken a few years to get the whole framework in place. So that's why this past 2019 is the first year it applies to all jurisdictions in Canada. I point to the issue of competitiveness and ways to help prevent leakage to other jurisdictions which may not have as stringent pricing or other policies in place, which seem to be working. I've seen one major oil company change its headquarters to the United States, but not actually change production. So, I think it's still a work in progress. We'll see. But obviously, it's good that Mexico has got it in place too. It helps, the rising tide helps lift all boats, right? So we're not undercutting each other. And I think that's the extent we can get this put into trade agreements and at the WTO and through Paris, I think we won't be undercutting each other in the future.
A good answer, thank you. Dick?
So one thing I would say about China is that their enthusiasm for cap and trade, at least in the electricity sector, has not diminished in any way that I can tell, having been working with them now for some years. How they actually implement it next year, there are certainly uncertainties about that. How they extend it or whether they extend it to other sectors, there are certainly uncertainties about that. But I can say that in the electric sector, they are moving ahead seemingly fairly forcefully in terms of starting this scheme. So that's all I can say.
Okay. Nora.
Yeah, so to the question, so maybe I didn't explain right. So the national carbon price we are going to implement is, so not really in addition, as I said, to the ETS. So it covers the sectors which are not covered by the ETS, so the European system, right? So it only goes for the building and the transport sector, which is, again, a very sort of national sector, right? So they will be sort of dealing with a national carbon price in the future. And then, again, our power sector and heavy industry is covered by the European emission system. That's how it works. But to be fair, there's some bureaucracy definitely needed to figure out who's covered by which, right? Mm-hmm. But we definitely want to cover more sectors with the national carbon price we are implementing. And I think also to your question again about sort of quantity and the price, we do have experience, right? We implement, we established in 2005 the European trading system. And so there's good amount of experience. And again, we didn't see bigger shifts. And that's why I'm sort of complaining and mentioning again and again that the price clearly isn't strong enough, so high enough to really make us shift towards greener and cleaner technologies, right? And that's why I'm just mentioning again, it has to be a higher price. And if you talk about quantities, the certificates would need to be lowered, much higher. Or you come up with more policies adjusting that whole system. And I think, maybe one last point, social justice, of course, is a big also question in that. And our neighboring country, France, has seen some backlash towards new climate policies, unfortunately. And that is for good reasons, because the individual peoples do fear higher costs for their daily commute and so on. And so I think we also have to be more creative, and Germany has now come up with the idea to pay to each household now that we are implementing this carbon price, which will rise costs for gas for your car and so on. So we will implement a bonus system per household to pay $110 per household every year to sort of balance out the higher costs. So that's one of the answers we give to that. Mm.
And is part of the German proposal to also advocate for a price floor at the EU level in the ETS? Is that correct, or do you know about that?
What do you mean by a price floor? In addition to the...
And just part of a policy reform at the EU level, I understood that Germany was going to advocate to the European Commission for a minimum price at the...
That is true. There is discussions where to set, and again, also by lowering the certificates.
Yes.
So it's all a combination of policies,
okay, right?
And setting a minimum price, that's true.
Okay. Yeah. And finally, we're just about to close, but I want to invite Celine, if you want to come back up to the podium, and do you want to dare tackle the question of what it's going to take to get to zero?
I'm not on. Okay. The answer is pretty easy. So two things. First, actually, with the Stern-Stiglitz Commission, we didn't do our own new modeling. It was merely a literature review, and we had a commission composed of 13, I think, world-renowned economists. So we relied on what models were already out there, including from, I'm sure, our friends at RFF, our friends at Brookings next door. So we built on what was out there. And what we looked at was Paris goal in terms of temperature, so we say 2 degrees, if possible 1.5, but if you look at what that means in conversion to net zero, it's pretty aligned. Like, we need to get to net zero by mid-century or second half century. So I would think that the numbers I presented are pretty aligned, and Norway is one of the few champions in my little segment there.
Okay. Well, now I want to thank you, the audience, for being very patient, and thank the panelists and Celine for this excellent presentation. Great job. That was